Okay, so this is where we stopped yesterday. We looked at the observations that describe the circulation in the world oceans. We looked at what are called the subtropical gyres. Then we saw what constitutes these gyres. There's a strong western boundary current. Gulf Stream is an example in the Atlantic. There is a much weaker equatorward flow of the eastern boundary. Then this return flow that is equatorward.
That's skin bitch. We can switch off from here. The inverse microphone. That page only. Click here. Okay.
But then how do they come in? They can switch again. Okay, so there's a western boundary current that is strong. There's a much weaker equatorward flow at the eastern boundary. But the return flow that is equatorward is not restricted to the eastern boundary. It takes place right across the basin. And one of the strong return flows is just adjacent to, just east of the boundary current itself. Then there is the equatorial current system. And we said that this kind of circulation that we're talking of, and the kind that we'll be looking at in the Indian Ocean, North Indian Ocean later, constitutes only one part of the kind of motions we see in the world oceans. And that is out here. We'll be looking at large-scale currents and planetary waves. Eddies would come in what's called mesoscale and interseasonal variability. We're not going to be looking at it. The time scale is shorter than for large scale currents of planetary waves, and so is the spatial scale. In fact, this blob can probably extend much farther to the shorter scale in space. We're also not going to be looking at global thermal line circulations. We're not going to be looking at storm surges or tides, or we'll look at inertial motions to some extent, and we'll not be looking at wind waves and swells. So we're looking at one aspect of ocean circulation, but this is something that is important. It's important for climate. So there's a reason why we study this. We're looking at geophysical fluid dynamics. So though we want to apply Newton's laws, we have to apply it to a fluid, which means we're going to be looking at a field. We can't use the law as written down for solid body dynamics. So there's a difference that comes in. And we're also looking at a very thin fluid. So if this is the length of the ocean basin, if it's, this is the horizontal scale, then the thickness of this line gives the depth that we're talking about. So it's a very thin fluid. It's on a sphere. So spherical coordinates is important. The sphere rotates, and that brings in an important pseudo force called the Coriolis force. The centrifugal force is invariably taken in by looking at the deviation of the Earth from a sphere. There is a deviation in the shape, and that accounts for the centrifugal force. So the important force that we end up looking at is the Coriolis force. Then there is stratification, which in the oceans is stable. You're looking at lighter water overlying heavier water. And for the kind of time scales and space scales we're talking of, this is perfect. So we're not going to look at short scale events in which you might find turbulent mixing taking place because of some cooling at the surface. So we are not looking at those kind of motions. And the nature of the flow depends on the scale, and that you can see from here. And there's a vast separation in scales. So the global thermal line circulation is very different from wind waves and swells. And they are different from the kind of motions we'll be looking at. Okay. So what are the basic consequences of scale and rotation? One thing is that we have a low aspect ratio. So we have a very small depth scale in comparison to the horizontal scale. And if I take a parcel of water, parcel is defined in fluid mechanics to be an entity that is small enough for us to be able to define properties. That is, please switch off the mobiles.
Linux mobiles. Hello. Okay. Let's invite it. Or again.
Okay, so parcel is something, an entity in the fluid that is small enough for us to define properties like pressure or density. You will not see a variation in the property across the parcel. That is important because otherwise you can't define a property for the parcel. So it is small enough for you to be able to do that. At the same time, it is large enough for averages to be valid. So you're not going to look at the molecular scale, for example. There are sufficiently large number of molecules within the parcel for an average to be defined, for quantity like pressure to be defined. Because pressure is a statistical average of molecular motion. So we can define pressure. Now, if we take such a parcel and say we move it across the Pacific from the bottom of the western boundary, hypothetical motion, from the bottom of the western boundary to the surface at the eastern boundary. In the horizontal, you would have 20,000, but in the vertical, we have traveled just a few kilometers. Okay. So if you look at the ratio of the vertical velocities associated with this kind of motion to the horizontal velocities, which we typically call currents, that we measure with a current meter, the ratio is very small. And that is a consequence of this low aspect ratio. We'll find that we can make a very important approximation called hydrostatic approximation, which reduces the vertical component of the momentum equation to a very simple balance, in which the gradient of pressure in the vertical is balanced just by rho into g. It's a static balance. It simplifies the equations considerably and makes the kind of solutions that we'll be looking at possible. If this was not done, if this was not valid, then many of the solutions that we'll be looking at would not be possible. Rotation implies Coriolis force, and it turns out that in geophysical flows, Coriolis force dominates. You can do a full-fledged course in fluid mechanics and engineering and not study practically any waves. That's not true here. We are going to make approximations to the equations, and we'll find that of interest to us practically throughout the course are waves. We're going to be looking at wave motion, though not of the kind that we see on the surface when we go out to sea. It's a different kind of wave motion, but it is something that is ubiquitous in the oceans. So this is one fundamental difference between classical fluid flows and geophysical fluid flows. The feature most striking in geophysical flows is waves. And that, it turns out, happens because the Coriolis force, which is a pseudo force, is the one that plays a critical role in the momentum balance. The Coriolis force is a strange force. Unlike the centrifugal force, it acts only when there is motion. So there must be relative motion between that parcel of fluid and the earth. So the parcel of fluid has to move with respect to the rotating earth in order for the Coriolis force to come into play. So if you look at the equation, you will find that the term for the Coriolis acceleration has some quantity that depends on latitude multiplying velocity. So when velocity is zero, there's no Coriolis acceleration. And equally truly, when that term dependent on latitude, which basically goes as sine theta, where theta is the latitude, goes to zero, that's at the equator, there is no Coriolis acceleration. So the Coriolis acceleration goes from zero at the equator to a maximum at the poles. It comes into play only when there is motion. Now, of interest to us in the Indian Ocean is basin that is essentially tropical. The northern boundary of the Arabian Sea is roughly at 25 north. So we are talking of an essentially tropical basin. And in this case, we cannot ignore the regime at the equator, where the Coriolis acceleration goes to zero. And we also go to a regime around 15 to 20 north, where the Coriolis acceleration is going to be the dominant player in the force balance. So we are looking at a regime where the changes in the Coriolis acceleration will have to be taken into account. Anyway, we'll come to that later. Two kinds of balances turn out to be very important when you look at the geophysical flows. One is Ekman flow, in which friction balances Coriolis force. We'll take a look at that a little later. The other one is called geostrophy. It comes from a Greek word, in which the pressure gradient balances Coriolis force. Both are steady balances. In the Ekman balance, friction balances Coriolis force. So there is steady motion. There is friction associated with that steady motion, and the two balance out. In the case of geostrophy, there's a pressure gradient, and that balances the Coriolis force. So in both cases, you have motion, and you have a static balance. So you're basically looking at steady situations. Let's look first at Ekman flow. Now, if you were to take a tank of water, and say you pull a sheet on top of it, take a stiff aluminium sheet and just pull it horizontally as a shear force on the water surface, what you will find, what do you think will happen to the water? How will it move? Which direction will the water move?
In the direction of the
sheet, right? So the water moves in the direction in which you pull the sheet. Is that okay? That's typically what you will find. You go out, take a reasonably sized tub, pull a sheet on top, and you will find the water moves in the direction in which you pull the sheet. And that is what you find in classical fluid flows. But when you come to the ocean, the problem is different. One problem is that you are talking of large scales now. So suppose you have a situation where you can ignore the changes in the water level, where you don't have any pressure gradients. Let's say we are looking at a situation of that kind. So you have this sheet that is being pulled on the surface. That's the wind. Okay, so the wind blows on the surface of the ocean. And in the ocean, initially the water starts moving in the same direction as the wind. But the moment the water starts flowing, the Coriolis acceleration comes into play. And if you look at the term governing the Coriolis acceleration, there is a cross product with the velocity. That cross product implies that the force acts at right angle to the motion. And once you have a force at right angles to the motion, you have an unbalanced force, so the velocity vector turns. And this velocity vector turns until the forces will balance out. So there are two things that happen. One, the motion starts in the direction of the wind, the Coriolis acceleration comes into play, and the velocity vector turns. The other thing that happens is the velocity decreases with depth, because your wind is blowing only at the surface. So the transfer of momentum is imparted at the surface, and that decays as you go down. So at some depth, the momentum that you have put in decays to zero. So your velocity vector turns. But when you look at any layer here, for example, you find that there is a stronger motion above it and a weaker motion below it. So there is a shear. That's what you're seeing. So this vector turns, and the velocity vector rotates, but it ends up rotating at a different angle as you go down. And the depth that we normally consider, the E-folding scale, that is the velocity magnitude goes to 1 by E of the value at the surface, is reached where the velocity vector turns 180 degrees on what you see at the surface. So at that point, you say that you have what is called the depth of the Ekman layer, or in terms of classical fluid mechanics, the boundary layer. Okay. Now, you still must have a balance at each level. And that balance now has to be between the frictional force at the surface, you have a shearing force given by the wind, and below it, there is slow moving fluid. So between them, there is shearing motion. So you have, you end up with a second grade, second derivative of the velocity vector, the horizontal velocity, and second derivative in the vertical. So you have d2v by dz squared, and that is the friction term. That will have to balance out the Coriolis acceleration. On average, this vector is turning and it's basically spiraling. So it's decreasing in magnitude and the direction turns as you go down. On average, over the layer, once you integrate to get the transport in that layer, you find that that motion is at right angles. And that is the only way to balance the force, because you have your wind stress here in this direction, and the Coriolis force has to be in the opposite direction in order to balance it on average over the layer, which means that the motion has to be at right angles. The details change as you go down, because you have the wind blowing this way, you have a shearing motion below it because the vector turns, and magnitude is decreasing. So the Coriolis acceleration in any slice is not going to be directly opposite to the wind. And that is why the vector also will not be at 90 degrees to the wind. It is only the average that's at 90 degrees to the wind. On average, you have the frictional force acting in the direction of the wind and the Coriolis acceleration acting in the opposite direction. But you take any given slice, you can work out the balance. And what you end up with is a very neat spiral. In observations, the spiral has rarely been noticed. One problem is that the assumptions made in under which this kind of balance holds ignores many other terms in the momentum balance. A critical thing that is ignored is pressure gradient. We are also assuming that the balance is steady, which is not too bad, but it is a problem in that you are ignoring any changes in water level. You're assuming that water level is flat, so that the balance lies between the friction and the Coriolis acceleration. So the spiral has rarely been observed, but the integral of the transport being at right angles to the right wind, that is robust. So this is something that holds, and that is what makes Ekman flows so important. Now, when you say that Ekman flow is important, you're saying that the Coriolis acceleration is so important that there are times when it can balance the stress imposed by the wind. The moment you make that statement, you are automatically excluding regions in the vicinity of the equator, where the Coriolis acceleration is vanishingly small. So this kind of a balance weakens as you come closer to the equator. So this balance is something that was postulated by Ekman, who was told by a friend of his, a biologist, who on a mission to the Arctic found that the icebergs were drifting not in the direction of the wind, but at an angle to the wind. This paper was published by Ekman in 1905, the same year that Ludwig Prandtl published his paper on boundary layer theory. A year prior to that, Prandtl had given a lecture in Göttingen on boundary layer theory. And it's quite likely that the basic idea came from there. So Ekman applied that directly to the ocean, and he made the approximations that were necessary to get the kind of flow that was seen by his friend Nansen. The So the details of the Ekman flow, that is the spiral, have rarely been seen, because the kind of approximations that Ekman made in order to get this spiral are normally not something that hold in nature. But the integral, that is the transport, is at right angles, does hold, and that is what makes segment flow so important in quantum. Now, both these papers were in 1905, but practically all the developments in boundary layer theory later were to come in the laboratory. The reason being that you can do controlled experiments in the laboratory. It's very difficult to make measurements in the ocean. Even today, it's an expensive business, and in those days, it was much tougher. So, developments in fluid flow theory were made in the laboratory, and we're still struggling to apply them to the kind of scales that we see in the ocean. You look at turbulence, you're typically talking of turbulence in small boxes when you do simulations of the Navier-Stokes equations. But when you come to the ocean, you're talking of an incredible array of scales. Your box itself is huge, but then your dissipation finally has to occur at the molecular level. You still have to account for that fluid passing. So the problem is that you have an incredible range of scales that makes it necessary to handle the dissipation due to friction by certain other means. So it's not surprising that most developments in fluid flows were to occur in the laboratory. And attempts are made to apply them in different forms to what you see in geophysical flows. So this is one major flow, Ekman flow, where the balance is between the applied wind stress and the Coriolis acceleration that results because of the motion that the wind imparts to the surface of the ocean. The other one is geostrophy. So let's go back to our tank. We have this tank. Okay. There's water. I have a partition in the middle. And let's say I have higher water level on the right hand side. I take off the partition. What happens? Right. So it will flow from the high water level to the low water level because the gradient of pressure is in the opposite direction. And where you have high pressure to the low pressure, that is the direction of the pressure gradient force. So you have the gradient of pressure acting from low to high, and the pressure gradient force acts in the opposite direction. So the flow is from high to low pressure gradient, high to low pressure. But the trouble is that if you look at a similar situation in the ocean, that's not what happens. You have, let's say, high sea surface here, high sea level and low sea level here, the flow tends to be into the laptop or into the boat. Again, the problem is the following. Initially, the flow will start from high to low pressure, but then the Coriolis acceleration will come into play. And in the northern hemisphere, the cross product that is associated with the Coriolis acceleration and the sine of latitude, sine theta. Theta is positive in the northern hemisphere and negative in the southern hemisphere. So sine theta is positive in the northern hemisphere, negative in the southern hemisphere. And therefore, in the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere, you have opposite signs for the Coriolis term. In the northern hemisphere, the deviation is to the right, and in the southern hemisphere, to the left. So if you are looking again, as we did earlier for the wind at the northern hemisphere, then the flow will start from high to low pressure, but then the Coriolis acceleration will act to the right, and it will deviate the flow into the plane of the laptop. Once that happens, you have a pressure gradient in one direction, a Coriolis acceleration now. It's not yet balancing the pressure gradient force. It's at some angle to it because the flow is still not at the appropriate angle that the Coriolis force will completely balance the pressure gradient force. In order for that to be achieved, the two vectors have to be parallel and they have to be directed opposite. So the flow has to turn in a direction such that these two vectors will cancel out, the force vectors. And the only way that can happen is if the flow is into the plane of the water. That's what happens. Now, in the case of both Ekman and geostrophic flows, it takes time for this balance to be achieved. So initially, the flow is the way you expect it to be. You have the wind blowing, the flow, the water accelerates in the direction of the wind, and then the Coriolis acceleration comes into play and turns it. Likewise here, the flow is from high to low pressure. The Coriolis acceleration comes into play the moment there is motion and turns the velocity vector. and this balance is typically achieved in time period 2 pi by f, where f is the Coriolis parameter. That's 2 omega sine theta, theta is the latitude, and omega is the rate of rotation of the Earth. So off Goa, for example, at 15 degrees north, it's about 2 to 2.5 days. That's the kind of time it takes. Now we are talking of motions, large-scale currents, planetary waves, and so on. So we are talking of motions that are what we call sub-inertial. 2 pi by f is the inertial period. So of Goa, it is about 2 to 2.5 days. So we are not talking of motions that have a period less than that. We are talking of motions that have a period longer than that. And sufficiently long for these kind of balances to be attained. Now, f increases as you go further north, which means that the inertial period increases. And so the balance takes longer time to be attained as you go towards the pole. And it becomes better because as you go away from the equator, you are in a regime more and more where the Coriolis acceleration has the chance to dominate the circulation. As you come close to the equator, say you are at 5 degree north, the balance is more tenuous. There are terms in the momentum equation that have been ignored in looking at Ekman and geostrophic flows that can no longer be ignored.
Well, as you go towards the pole, the geostrophic balance takes less time. Weight is increasing. Inertial period decreasing.
Yes, sorry. As you go towards the pole, the inertial period decreases and the balance comes into play much faster. Right, sorry. And the Coriolis acceleration basically increases and therefore it basically ends up dominating the circulation. And that is why Ekman and geostrophic calculations are still done, because in what are called the mid-latitudes, that is the latitudes associated with subtropical jets, it is still a major factor. But this is striking. This is something very different from what we see in classical fluid flows. So in classical flows, if you're looking at a piston engine or you're solving for the flow over a car or an airplane, the flow takes place in a time scale that is much shorter than the time it takes for the Earth to rotate once on its axis. So the Coriolis acceleration plays no role. That's why it's not important. While here you're talking of motions that have a periodicity that is comparable to the period of the Earth's rotation. That's 1 day. So the moment you are talking of motions that have a period comparable to that of the Earth's rotation, it is something you can no longer ignore, the Coriolis acceleration. So that is the key thing. Okay, now if you look at this picture, it shows that the sea surface and the isobar, if you may call it that here, at any given depth, isobar is the contour of constant pressure, are at the same angle theta with respect to the horizontal. But in the ocean, there's something else that happens. You have a stratification. So suppose you have a situation where the isobars are tilted by the same angle theta, irrespective of whether you're looking at the surface or at some depth. Then the kind of flow you have is called barotropic flow. This is typical of tides and also typical of phenomenal like tsunamis. So when you solve for tides and tsunamis, you generally tend to ignore the stratification. So you can look at the average density of the ocean, you can factor that into the calculations, and you can essentially get rid of the third dimension, that is depth. The only role of depth then is in that it changes in the ocean, and that has an impact on the propagation of the tide, but otherwise it's of no consequence. So the wave speed would simply be square root of g into h. G is the acceleration due to gravity and h is the local depth. That's it. There's nothing else that comes into play. But that's not how the ocean normally behaves. When you talk of the wind driving the circulation, the wind stress is put in at the surface and it decays as you go down. So the wind, if it were to cause a tilt in the isobar, and we shall see how it will do that later, if it were to cause a tilt of the isobar at the surface, certain tilt theta, it cannot cause the same tilt as you go down, because the effect of the wind has to decay as you go down into the as the depth increases. We saw that. That's how the Ekman flow, Ekman balance is obtained. That's a boundary layer. You put in a stress, the effect of the stress has to decay as you go down. So the way tides are forced is different. The way the tsunamis are forced is different. The entire water column oscillates in the case of the tide and the tsunami. That's not what we're talking of when we're looking at wind force motions. The motion decays as you go down. So what happens is that you have a certain tilt of the isobar at the surface, but as you go down, that tilt theta decreases with depth. And there's probably a depth at which it is negligibly small. And then you could say that my isobar is level. It's horizontal. And if that is horizontal between two stations A and B, then there cannot be any geostrophic flow at this depth. Right? Because there's no pressure gradient. The pressure at A at this depth, which is Z naught, that's the reference level, is the same as the pressure at B at the reference level. So there is no horizontal pressure gradient, and therefore there is no geostrophic flow. But I have temperature and salinity data at both A and B as a function of depth, which means I can calculate density as a function of depth. And I have the hydrostatic balance, because these are the kind of motions I'm looking at. So dP by dz is simply minus rho into g. That's the balance we'll see we attain. So I can assume pressure to be zero, pressure gradient, PB minus PA to be zero at depth z naught. And that means that I can get PB minus PA at any depth, because I know density at A and I know density at B as a function of depth. So that is all I'm doing. I calculate, I assume PA and PB to be zero at this depth. I can manually set that to zero. It's anyway the same. So my calculation is simplified if I set it to zero, and then I just keep integrating. So at any given depth, I can get PB minus PA at that depth, which means I can get the geostrophic current at that depth, but with reference to this level Z naught, where I say that the isobar is practically horizontal, and therefore there is no geostrophic flow. This becomes a fairly good approximation as you come to the top 100, 200 meters, because the currents at the surface are stronger than they are below on the kind of scales we are looking at. This kind of flow where you have a vertical shear and that is arising as a consequence of the stratification of the ocean is called baroclinic flow. This is crucial. We are not going to be looking at barotropic flows, because we have ruled out study of storm surges, tides, tsunamis, and so on. Our interest is in baroclinic flows. Okay. And we saw that we had two major sources of information on ocean currents. One was ship drifts, and we saw what ship drifts were yesterday. The other is hydrographic data, temperature and salinity profiles. The reason we still collect them today is because if they are used sensibly, they can still give you an estimate of the geostrophic component of the tide. It is true that it is one aspect of the flow, but if your latitude is such that you are reasonably far from the equator, it is still a fairly important component of the flow. So when I have temperature and salinity profiles at two stations A and B, since the flow practically vanishes because the isobar tends to become more and more horizontal as you go down, there comes a depth which is typically called the reference level or level of no motion. That's the term used in oceanography, level of no motion, where you assume it to be flat. The isobar is flat, so there is no pressure gradient there, and I have density at both A and B, so I can calculate the average geostrophic current at any depth between A and B, average between A and B at any depth relative to that level of no motion. And I can also integrate from that level of no motion to the surface. So I can get the transport associated with the current relative to the level of no motion. This is what we mean when we say the transport of the Gulf Stream is 150 swept. That is how it's being done. Otherwise, you will have to put an incredible array of current meters. You have to sample across the Gulf Stream, you have to sample in depth, and that is not the way the measurements are made. So these are indirect measurements. It's an estimate of the flow, but it is one of the major sources of information on ocean currents. So these are the kind of flows we are going to be looking at. Okay. The question now is, why do we study the noise, not just the signal?
For transport calculation. Now we, for Gulf Stream suppose, we have to integrate it over the, across the Gulf Stream and over the day. But across the Gulf Stream, the friction will be too high. So in that case, this balance will not hold.
Okay, the question is that when you want to calculate the transport of the Gulf Stream, you have to integrate in depth, which is fine, but you also have to integrate across the Gulf Stream. And the point being made is that friction will be too high and therefore this balance will not hold. It's only partly true. The problem is that when you look at the Gulf Stream, you can see a tilt of the sea surface across the Gulf Stream. Earlier it was not measurable except through this kind of calculation. You could estimate how much the Gulf Stream how much the sea surface should tilt across the Gulf Stream. It's something of the order of a meter. We're talking several tens of centimeters to a meter. This was not measurable by satellites until the Tupex Poseidon or GeoSat mission came into play. That was in the mid-80s. But today you can measure to a reasonable accuracy, something like 3 centimeter tilts. 3 to 3.5 centimeters is the accuracy for the Indian Ocean. Indian Ocean accuracy is typically lower because of the changing circulation. It's a little better if you go to the Atlantic or the Pacific, where the seasonal cycle is not such a strong component of the circulation. The mean flow dominates. That's what we're looking at. So across the Gulf Stream, you have that tilt in the sea surface. So that tilt is what is driving that large-scale current. So if you have several stations across the Gulf Stream, you will still get a fairly representative average of the Gulf Stream transport. Okay, now first let me explain what I mean by noise and signal here. Now what you see here is the sea level recorded at Apollo Bandar, which has, Apollo Bandar is in Mumbai. It has a tide gauge, the longest tide gauge record in the Indian Ocean. It was established in the late 1870s and recorded continuously till 1994 when the Mumbai Port Trust decided for some reason to close it down. And it was restarted after the tsunami in 2004. There's no other station in the Indian Ocean that has a record this long. Aden has a record that ends in 1967 when the British left Yemen. The only two other tide gauges in the tropics that have a comparable record are Balboa in the Panama Canal and Honolulu in Hawaii, which is practically not the tropics because it's almost at the Tropic of Capricorn. Which was the northern one? Capricorn or Cancer? Cancer. So it's Tropic of Cancer. So Honolulu is almost not tropics. So if you're talking in terms of tropical sea level, there were only two tide gauges that would give you a long-term trend. One is at Mumbai and the other is at Balboa, the Panama Canal. So you have a long record. Now what has been done here is to plot different aspects of the tide gauge record. The top panel, which has data from 16 May to 15 June of 1976, has an ordinate in centimeters that goes from minus 250 to plus 250. What is plotted in red is the raw record. And you can see that the tides of Mumbai have a range of something like 4 to 5 meters. Okay. Then we average the data. We take a daily mean, running mean, and that running mean has been plotted in blue over this red curve. The second panel shows you the same data. The blue curve has been replotted here, but now the ordinate is changed. It goes from minus 40 to plus 40 centimeters. And that blows up the small signal you see here, and that is what you see. This was a storm surge. It had a range of about 40 centimeters, and it occurred towards the end of May and the first week of June. So it was about 1/10 the range of the tide of Mumbai. 10%, that's it. Now I have a daily sea level. I can calculate that daily sea level over the whole year 1976, and that's what's been done here. The range is still the same, minus 40 to plus 40, but now going from January to December, that's the blue curve. And the storm surge appears in this fashion towards the end of May and early June. This part is what you see here. Okay. Now, just as I went from hourly sea level to daily sea level, I can go from daily sea level to monthly sea level. That's what's plotted here for 1976. That's the red curve in panel 3. Now, apart from storm surges, you see that you have interseasonal variability shown in the blue curve. The range is something like 20 to 40 centimeters. The red curve, in contrast, has a range of maybe about 20 centimeters. It's replotted here. The ordinate has changed now, minus 20 to plus 20. The red curve shows you the curve for January. But I have a record that is almost a century long. So I can average it for all Januaries, all Februaries, and so on to create what's called a climatology. That is the blue curve. So the blue curve shows you the climatology of monthly sea level. The red curve is the monthly sea level for 1976. In either case, the range is something like 10 to 20 centimeters. This is typically what we are going to be talking about. So the question is, why do you want to study it at all? Does it make any difference? That's the question we have to answer. But before we go into that, let's see something else here. If you compare the curve for 1976 and the climatology that's in blue, you find that there are many similarities. And that's not surprising because the monsoon cycle is fairly regular. You expect the monsoon to set in roughly around the 1st of June in Kerala. Mumbai's canonical onset date is 10th of June. So you expect a regularity associated with this monsoon cycle, the seasonal cycle of the monsoons. So it's not surprising that the two curves are similar. But there are sufficient deviations. The May sea level was much lower in 1976 compared to the climatology. And that means there is variability from year to year. So there is a regularity associated with the monsoon, but there is variability from year to year. So these are both aspects of the same phenomenon. And that is what makes it so difficult. There is an almost unbelievable regularity. But at the same time, the perturbations are such that they are a life or death issue, in particular with respect to rainfall. Now we go one step further in the last panel. The monthly sea level, the climatologies are discarded. The red curve now shows you the annual sea level. So you see interannual variability. This should be interannual. Should be interannual. So the red curve shows you interannual variability, and again you can see that the oscillations are of the order of about 10 centimeters. The ordinate is now from minus 10 to plus 10. You can decimate the data further. You can calculate decadal running means, 10-year running means, and that's the blue curve. So you can see that sea level was low till about 1925, rose sharply with the peak around 1950s, and then it decreased till the end of this record, which was around 1988. It decreased even further till sometime in the 90s and then has increased again following that. So it's not a smooth trend. Depending on your record, if for example you had a record that was looking at just 1925 to 1950, you would estimate a very strong rise in sea level. But then there are tide gauges like the one at Mangalore, which were installed sometime in the 60s. And if you look at the tide gauge record till the 80s, you actually find a trend that is decreasing. And that's what makes long-term measurements useful. So that range, again, interannual and interdecadal variability, are talking of 10 to 20 centimeters. So these are small perturbations on the tides. So why are we spending time in this course looking at the seasonal cycle when it is a few percent of the tide? So why do we study the noise in this signal? and not the signal itself, that is the tiles. Why do you at all have to attend a course on this? The problem is the following. Suppose you look at the density profile in the oceans. You can see three kinds of curves here. This is typical of the polar latitudes. This is what you would find in the tropics, and an average, say for the mid latitudes, would be the solid line in the middle. I think this would be the tropics. But in any case, if you exclude the polar part, what you find is that you have a surface layer of a few tens of meters where the density is low in comparison to the density that is not changing much over the bulk of the ocean. That's why you can assume density to be constant in many kinds of calculations. And this change is also small. Look at the scale, it's 1.024. Here, and this is 1.028. So you're talking of a change in the third decimal place in terms of gram per cc, and in terms of kg per meter cube, it is in the units place when you're talking of 1000 kg per meter cube. So these are small changes. But there is a surface layer, few tens of meters thick, where you have low density. And you have a layer below, which is roughly constant. And in between, density changes. It changes quite sharply. This region where the density changes sharply is called the picnic line. Over most of the world oceans, this change in density in this picnic line is driven by temperature. And the region where the temperature decreases sharply, and therefore the density increases sharply, the part where the temperature increases sharply is called the thermic line. If the change is due to salinity, as you find in the Bay of Bengal, in the Northern Bay, you have a lot of fresh water coming in, overlying saltier, denser water. The density changes near the surface are determined by salinity, not by temperature. It is the salinity that brings down the density at the surface in comparison to the deeper layer. And what you find is a sharp change in salinity at the base of the surface mixed layer. That is the haloclinic. So what we are looking at here is the pycnocline. And if I were to build a mathematical model, I could simplify this considerably by assuming a surface layer of constant density, a deeper layer of another constant density that is greater than the surface density, and collapse this pycnocline to an interface. So I could build a two-layer ocean model. Now, the ocean is stratified, and that is why you have a two-layer model. So this is distinct from what you would do for the tides, where you would not bother about this change in density. You would just look at a constant density, and you could go ahead and calculate, because you are interested only in the barotropic current, the change in sea level. It's not going to be different at the surface as compared to something in between. That's what is of interest to you when you're talking of this tide. Of course, the tide is not as strong as 4 meters in the middle of the ocean, but whatever it is, it's not going to be something that varies dramatically as you go down. The pressure doesn't change that way. But in the kind of flows that we are interested in, you could look at the ocean as a two-layer system. Now, in that case, what happens is the following. You have density rho 1 here, which is smaller than density rho 2 below. So suppose you have a tilt in the sea surface. Okay, now when you look at the, when you draw a line out here, okay, horizontally, you look at the line drawn. Suppose this left side is A and the right side is B. You draw this line from this level, the horizontal level. When you look at this difference in pressure, you have water out here of density rho 1, that's 1000 kg per meter cube, or 1 gram per cc, and you have air out here, whose density is 1/1000th that of water. So a small change in sea level can cause a large difference in pressure between this point and this point. Remember that just 10 meters of the water column is equal to the pressure of the entire atmosphere above. pressure changes by 1 bar in the ocean for every 10 meters. And the changes in atmospheric pressure between two locations will never come anywhere near a bar. So I don't need a 10 meter change in sea level. This change in sea level will typically be in terms of centimeters, a few tens of centimeters, because that is all I need to balance the difference in air pressure between these two points. But as we go down, when you look at this point, look at this point versus this point out here. Now I draw a line here. Okay. There's no difference in the density here and here. So whatever pressure gradient you have over here is transmitted undiminished to this point. But once you come below this point out here on the left, you have a higher density here compared to what you find here. So the pressure here will now be higher than the pressure here at this depth locally. I'm not accounting for what has happened above. So the pressure being higher here compared to the pressure here is now being balanced by a reversal in the pressure gradient in the second layer. The trouble is that the difference in density between layer 1 and layer 2 is in the third decimal place if you're looking at CGS units, in contrast to practically 1 gram per centimeter cube when I'm looking at the surface. So it takes a much larger tilt of this picnic line or the interface to balance out the small change in sea level at the surface. So even if my sea level range in terms of in the seasonal cycle is just 10 to 20 centimeters, the changes associated with it in the picnic line are not small. The rule of thumb would be a factor of 30. So what you end up with is, if you have a change of 10 centimeters here, factor of 300, because you have, say, a change of 3 or 4 kg per meter cube versus 1000 kg per meter cube here. So that's the factor you're looking at. So if you have a change in sea level between the left and the right points here, say A and B, of 10 centimeters, you multiply by, say, 300. That is 3000 centimeters or 30 meters. That is the change in picnic line between A and B. And they have to go in opposite directions. So if sea level rises at B, the picnic line will go down at B. Okay, so that is what is of interest to us. With the tide, if this difference in sea level between A and B is 4 meters, this surface will also give me the same difference of 4 meters. I'm not talking of that anymore. A change of 10 centimeters in sea level, which is measurable today from satellite ultimately, gives me a change of something like 30 meters out here. That is not small. You compare the 30 meters with the depth of the mixed layer that you see here, which is again typically of the same order, you're talking of 50 to 100 meters, you're talking of fairly large changes. And it is this surface layer of roughly constant temperature that the atmosphere can tap. It is like a plate, a heated plate from which the atmosphere can pick up heat. And the ocean always has moisture to supply. So it can pick up that moisture. If the ocean is warm enough, the moisture will be picked up. And you can have a moist atmosphere ready to convect in the tropics. If the layer is 10 meters thick, I have so much heat that I can tap. It's a thin plate. If that layer is 40 meters thick, I have much more heat that I can tap. It's more difficult to change the temperature of a 40 meter thick layer than to change the temperature of a 10 meter thick layer. So the 40 meter thick layer is a more constant source of heat, as you look at in thermodynamics. It's a reservoir that you can tap more easily without changing its temperature. The 10 meter thick layer is not like that. That is what makes it so important. That is why we are interested in what might be considered the noise, and we are going to ignore this signal in sea level. So we will exploit altimeter data, but our interest is not in the time. Our interest is not in the large signal of a few meters, but in the small oscillations that it reveals of a few centimeters. This is the reason we study them.
So,
this
kind of difference is there, as in if there is a slant in the sea surface, due to geostrophy, there can be upwelling motion. So that time the density distribution can change.
Okay, can we come back and take a look at it? We'll take a break now. Fine, so we take a break for about 10 minutes. We'll be back after that. And if there are any questions, we'll take that, because after that we go into the wind forcing and the causes of the circulation that we had seen earlier. And this is going to be a very brief tour of the theory. So we'll look at the wind forcing and then just go over what those theories were. And we'll take a look at them in detail as we go through the course. Fine. So if you have any questions, we'll take them after 10 to 15 minutes. So we take a break now and come back after that.